employee are accountable, that they are accountable. If they're going to receive public funds, we have to make sure that they're doing what they're supposed to do, and those students are learning and achieving, and those school staffs are supported, those teachers are supported in their mission in teaching our children. The bottom line is, we want our children to achieve. We want our students to learn. And in order for that to happen, we have to support our communities, we have to support our parents, we have to support the stakeholders. We must reinvest in our schools to make sure that they have the resources necessary to do their job. And so holding local schools accountable, holding charter schools accountable, making sure that everybody's doing their job and educating the children here in our local district. And if we're doing that, and if our local schools are achieving and our students are learning, then there won't be a need for parents to pull the trigger on that local school. There won't be a need for us to reconstitute, or restructure, or turn our local schools over to charter if those schools are doing their job and that's what they're supposed to do.
Thank you.
Schooling by the same measures. Mm-hmm. There are charter public schools, and they are public schools. They're chartered by the Los Angeles Unified School District. It doesn't just pop up from nowhere. There are innovation design schools. There are magnet schools. There are alternative schools. There are lots of different models of schooling for young people. The only issue that a board member should be concerned with is whether or not all schools are being evaluated using the same measure. So if a charter public school is doing better at educating the same type of student, we need to find out what they're doing. And we need to find out whether we can bring that up to scale. We need to find out whether we can import that to traditional public schools. If a charter school is failing, it needs to be closed. There's no question about it. The charter should be revoked and the school should be closed. But also for traditional public schools who have been in the school improvement program, sometimes for years, especially in Board District 1, we need to reconstitute those schools too. We need to close those schools, we need to reconstitute them, and we need to open them up with a different set of adults who can get us different results, different outcomes for children. So it's not for me so much whether or not we should expand them or we should stop offering charters as how we're evaluating them and what we're learning from charter schools. Board District 1 has more charter schools in this district than in any other district in the Los Angeles Unified School District. We need to understand why that is so. What is it that parents are so unhappy about that they are taking their youngsters out of traditional public schools and placing them in charters?
I agree with Rachel. She mentioned that charter schools are here, and they're here. I think, again, mentioning the evaluation process. Charter, and we're mentioning our charter public schools. And public schools are using public dollars. And therefore, as a charter public school, you need to accept all of our public students. Charters that do not have the acceptance of all of our students need to be changed, bottom line. There's no way you can use our public dollars and make it a private institution. And that needs to change. Therefore, if there's a school that has a charter that does not look like our traditional public schools that accepts every student, whether they have a disability, whether they need special services, then those schools need to be checked. And that's just the bottom line of it, because it's public dollars that are funding these schools, and therefore the charter has to resemble that. Public schools where I'm working at, we accept all of our students. We provide services for the English language learner. We provide service for resource students. We provide services for those students. We do not turn them away, we accept them. And charters need to do the exact same thing. If they're gonna use the public dollar, they have to service every student. And that's how it should be.
Totally different. One question that I always ask all parents,
taking children out of Greater Public School. The reason that they take their children out of public school for two reasons. Number one, safety. Number two, the class size. Many times it's not about learning. It's making sure that their child is safe. And I think it's important what I always tell parents, because I do visit some of the charter schools and I do talk to parents. I say, you need to go in to see what your child is learning. Your child will tell you, oh, I love this school. But my question, is he learning or is she learning anything? And so it's important, parents, for you to be engaged in your child's school, whether it's a traditional public school or whether it's a charter school. Charter schools, there are some excellent charter schools. I can name a few. I mean, excellent. Send out some students to any of our colleges and universities. However, just like you have excellent public schools, traditional public schools, you also have some bad charter schools and you have some bad public schools, traditional. But why do you have bad public schools and bad charter schools? The question lies with us. We cannot compare a charter school to a traditional public school. Why? Let's look at the enrollment. You have over 600,000 students in a regular LA Unified School District. Where in a charter school, you might only have 200 or 300 students. That's important. It's important to the community. Something else you need to realize is that you do not find charter schools in high, I don't want to say economic areas, but that's the truth. You only find charters in low-income areas.
Thank you.
But
because I did not do this in the midst of my stage fright here in the beginning.
It's all right. It's funny.
We forgot to do the introduction of the candidates and allow the candidates to introduce themselves. We sort of just jumped the gun here and just went straight to the point. So as you guys are thinking of your last many questions, and as the cards are being collected, I want to ask the candidates to give a 1 minute elevator speech, or elevator, 1 minute 30 seconds. Or you can do it in your closing as the questions are being collected. Some are choosing, they're telling me to do it in their closing. So, as the cards are being collected, we will go right into
on the fly. Unlike LAUSD.
There we go. It's a working school board right here.
Let's replace the present one with those guys. The whole thing.
Ask your guy to come on up and explain how the Q&A question from the audience will work.
And let's give Rashad a round of applause as well. So just so we're we're modeling the transparency that we want from LAUSD, correct? So that you guys didn't think that we're back here saying, I don't want Keith's question asked back here. What we did is we put them in categories so that we didn't have redundant questions. Some of these questions, just for time's sake, some of these questions that were submitted, the candidates sort of hit on already. So those were the ones that were put out. Not that they're bad questions. There's no conspiracy. You see it all in the public here. I haven't endorsed anyone, so just to be completely clear here. So what we want to do is put them in categories. So what we did is there were questions around budget. There is one question that I'm going to ask around personnel. This next category here were questions mainly around overall vision. That's this middle category here. There was one parent-oriented question here. There was one sort of student, very specific kind of student question here. And then these questions here was more about LAUSD structure. So we kind of put them in categories. Once again, does everybody get what we did here? So no one's going to go. My question was thrown away because, no one wanted to ask. No, it wasn't that. All the questions were good. Just some of them that were kind of redundant, we decided to kind of flip onto the side. So what we're going to do for time's sake, I also want to just also make it very clear that Rashad is actually, I misspoke actually, and I said role, it was actually Rashad who allowed me to have some changes in the questions earlier, so thank you so much. So this question here, and we are going to go back, start with Ms. Johnson, and go back. So this one is different. LAUSD employs, I believe, over 50,000 part-time employees, largely in our cafeterias, our teacher's assistants. And oftentimes, their voices seem to be very put to the side in terms of policies and budget priorities. And so, clearly, we have a situation with, especially with a lot of our food service, our instructional assistants. They only work a few months out of the year. Just in general, how can we make our part-time employees increase the support for our part-time employees, which make up a large portion of our workforce in LAUSD? Not by mistake, also, many of them tend to live local in District 1, in communities like District 1. How can we increase our support for part-time employees and make them a bigger part of what happens in the district?
First of all, you have to consistently meet with your employee stakeholder groups. You have to hear their concerns, and you have to welcome their input. You have to respect their voice. This is what I do as a member of the Gardena City Council. The City of Gardena also employs many part-time employees in addition to their full-time staff members. And every single employee is respected. Every single employee group is listened to. Every single employee group is invited to the table to discuss issues that would impact their quality of life and their ability to do their job on the local school campuses. And this is incredible. increasingly important because, as our moderator has said, many of our courses